Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Queen.
The thing about Queen is that they're really normal. Do you know what I mean? Like, this thing about, they don't have very many airs and graces, you know. They're very approachable people. They're very friendly. They're the most unlikely band I've ever seen. You sort of have this hippie guitar player who wears white clogs and long hair. You've got this very trendy drummer, you know, hey, the good-looking drummer. You've got this outrageous lead singer with this amazing voice. Yeah, and you've got the classic bass player who's sort of, you know, quiet and very into music and sort of thing like that. They're very unlikely to be one of the biggest bands on the planet.
Flash.
Bottoms.
Nuts.
Graduates. Futuristic. Piss artists.
We will rock you.
One word.
Dreadful.
Super. Yes,
yeah. We will rock you.
Queen. Four friends who have stayed together for the best part of two decades to become one of the 80s most successful rock bands. Four hard-rocking Englishmen who play to the biggest audiences in the world all around the world. Experimental musicians, pioneers of the pop video and untouchable live showmen. Who are these phenomenal four?
John Deacon was the first person in the group that made contact with me, in fact. He phoned up one day and just said, I hear you're a big fan of Queen. If you ever want to come to a concert sometime, you know, I'd like you to come. And I assumed he was a keen enthusiast of racing, or at least driving. So I said to him, you know, what kind of car do you drive? Think he would have a Ferrari or a Porsche or something. He says, I own a Volvo. And I thought, my God, anybody who owns a Volvo and is in rock music, there's something wrong.
Yeah. Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one gone, and another one gone. Another one bites the dust. Yeah.
When I was a tape op, and all I'd do was really just make tea and look after them and make sure the engineer and the producer were okay. Then I'd walk in and say, now, who'd like a cup of tea and who'd like a cup of coffee? And I'd go around all the band and I'd get to Brian and he'd say, now, how many teas are you making? I'd say, well, three teas. How many coffees are you making? Three coffees, Brian. Oh, so you're making the same amount. So would it matter if I had a coffee? No, I'll have a tea. Now, which is the easiest to make for you? And so it would take me half an hour for Brian to decide whether to have a cup of coffee or have a cup of tea. So when it came down to doing guitars, then you can imagine how long it used to take.
Well,
I see the hair's going. I'm very pleased with that. I was seeing the other night. She's had the old clone look for a long time now, and we thought yesterday it would be nice to have the old hair back again, but somebody pointed out that she may not be able to grow it. But that's all I'm going to be bitchy. He's wonderful. I love Freddie to death. Okay?
We are the champions, my friend.
The best way to describe Roger, I think, is that if you take off his glasses, he's yours.
He was always beating the living daylight out of a drum. He had this great fetish desire to be a pop star. I believe he made it as well, for that matter. I can remember, it was always alleged he ruined 5 or 6 academic careers while at school because he got other people involved in the group. I think the group was called the Cousin Jacks. I aren't certain about that. But I certainly remember him doing a gig, I think the word is, for the Young Liberals, because I was involved in politics all those years ago, and we lost money on it, which might be a reflection on the Young Liberals.
The most exciting period, which was like the early glam rock scene, which was like 71, 72. And it seemed as though every week there was a new group on Top of the Pops that looked great and sounded great. And, you know, you had one week Steve Harley and then Bowie and then Queen, Sparks. You know, one by one there was... that was just the era that I got into music, so... So it wasn't stupid to me because it was part of, you know, the Xandra Rhodes clothes and stuff were part of what was going on. I mean, somebody around the corner was doing something equally as silly or outrageous.
London at the beginning of the 70s was a city bustling with opportunities, its rigid conventions shaken loose by half a decade of swinging. And it was in this free atmosphere that the concept of Queen germinated. In this culturally active climate, the 4 students of design, dentistry, physics, and electronics met. It was back in 1967, however, that the band's story had begun, with a handwritten note pinned to an Imperial College notice board by Brian May.
And I suddenly realized that I couldn't stand not being in a group. So that's when I met Brian. Met him through my flatmate at Imperial College, which is a different college than mine. I met him in the bar one night because he wrote me a letter after I replied, "Add, we need Ginger Baker, Mitch Mitchell type drummer." And Brian wrote me this long, involved letter, and he sounded quite intelligent, you know, because he liked Jeff Beck and Jimi Hendrix. So I met him, and we got on very well. And that was the sort of beginning.
They called themselves Smile.
I used to follow sort of Smile a lot, you know. Oh. We were like friends. I used to go to their shows and they used to come to see mine.
Freddie was always so keen, and he literally sort of taught himself to play, to understand chords on a guitar, etc., etc.
Had Freddie had any experience at all?
None at all before Smile was formed. Absolutely none, apart from Cliff Richard impersonations in front of his mirror. Yesterday, my
life was in ruin. What did you see
in what Brian and Rog were doing with Smile?
Nothing. I don't know, I think they had the basic ingredients of what we wanted to do.
And Freddie sort of got us. He said, come on, you can't give up. I want to sing for you. And nobody really took him that seriously, but he really sort of fused it together. And then which made a core of the three of us.
And it was then I sort of thought about the name Queen. You know, at that time it sort of, the name sort of lent itself to a lot of things, a lot of the theatre, and it was very grand, you know, very pompous, all those kind of connotations. It meant so much, you know. It was nice. You couldn't sort of just, it wasn't just one precise label. It could have meant a lot of things. In the land where horses born with eagle wings and honeybees have lost their
stings, they're singing forever. Ooh, yeah. We just had a list this long of names. Queen was a name which I think in the beginning I didn't like very much, but we had a lot of discussion about it, and we figured if we were talking about the name, then it had something which stuck in your mind. You know, I always remember thinking that the Beatles was a terrible name.
In those days, Roger Taylor began running a clothes stall in Kensington Market. His partner, Freddie Mercury, had a plan for conquest of the rock world, and soon they were recording the first Queen demos.
So we cut some demos in Delane Lee.
So we took these four tracks around to everyone in sight, every record company in England. At that point, most of them were interested, but weren't prepared to commit themselves that much, obviously, because they want to see what the band's like on stage and everything else. And we weren't in a position to be very good on stage. We didn't have the equipment and everything.
There was one particular gig at Imperial College, and we were just building up a little bit of buzz because some of the gigs had been getting good. And this gig really went well. That was a very good turning point.
Very difficult for any group, the first album you do, always, the studio's a new thing, right? I mean, even on the first album, we managed to get in a bit, you know, I mean.
They signed to EMI a few months, around the same time as I did in 73. A few months either way, I don't know who was first. And one of us has been immensely successful.
They were a support act on a tour with a band called Mott the Hoople, and I remember thinking, what a bunch of tossers, they'll never make it. But I was wrong.
Queen, well, yes, although actually, of course, in the last sort of 10 years or so, I mean, it has meant so much, but I remember when they first appeared on the scene, there were all kinds of suggestions that they were all sort of homosexual or something, which of course they're not.
We weren't the kind of band that actually said, okay, we're gonna do this, but if it doesn't work out, we will follow what somebody else. No. That's the wrong way to do it. We were going to do that.
Freddie always had a good voice. That's always been the anchor of that group, I think. And Brian's good guitar player as well. You know, they've had musical skill. I think you can tell, you know, when a band's got musical skill. Try and help me, Father. Won't you let me in? Liar! But I think, as I say, the first thing you heard with Queen was Freddie's voice. And it's the same as it was then. It's a very strong voice, a very distinctive voice. And you recognize that this guy knows what he's doing.
I mean, you have to start with something outrageous. I think that's the best way to actually let the public know that you're on the scene.
Okay, there's a lot of show, there's a lot of camp, you know, which wouldn't, I wouldn't be too interested in, you know, but there's a market.
So in my day, as it were, I mean, that was the thing, glam rock was it, and so we just went for that. So I mean, clothes and glamour, and if I hadn't changed, I tell you, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you.
In late 74, Killer Queen stormed up the charts to number 2, giving the band their first major hit. She's a killer queen. Appropriately enough, in the year of lightweight Bay City roller pop, it was held off the number one spot by David Essex.
I first saw him on Top of the Pops with whatever it was, Killer Queen, and I thought they were brilliant. And I thought, hello, mate.
Hello, fella. How are you?
I'm telly.
All right.
I thought, yeah, they had potential. The ugly one, what's his name, who sings?
Freddie's a real one-off, and at that time, nobody looked like him. Nobody sang like him with the harmonies and everything. The group had a unique sound, and Freddie is to say, he was quite outrageous for that time.
I remember I was sitting, we all went out to dinner, and I was sitting next to Fred when I came into this restaurant, and Fred had on these really, really tight white satin pants. I mean, it was like he was poured into them, you know. And so he got to sit down, and before he sat down, he got to his seat, and he sort of looked from side to side, put his hands down, and undid his pants, because he couldn't sit down, he would have split his pants open. So he sort of looked around and went, and sat down. I always remember that. I just, you know, I thought it was just hysterical, what, you know, what you'll do for fashion.
She's a killer queen, gunpowder, gelatine, dynamite with a laser beam, guaranteed to blow your mind.
I it's very hard because it for me to look back on it because it's so many years ago now, and were we that shocking?
The first time we ever featured any music by Queen on Whistle Test was in July 24th, I think it was 1973. And it was a silly situation. What had happened is we received a white label, and for people who don't understand what a white label is, it's an early pressing of an album without any indication on it as to what the artist is or anything. It just comes totally clean off the presses. And someone had delivered it to the office and left it there. And they hadn't given any indication as to who it was, who it was from, anything like that. And I picked it up and put it on the turntable. I thought, I really like this. This is very different. I haven't heard anything like this before. And so I sent it off to a friend of mine who had a film collection of old films and said, look, cut something to this. I want to feature this in next week's programme. And in those days, videos, you know, were unheard of. It was before Bohemian Rhapsody or anything like that. And he came back with this piece of film, and it fitted it beautifully. It was the track was Keep Yourself Alive, and the actual film that was used was a bit of material that had been used by President Roosevelt for his campaign in the cinema. Keep yourself alive.
Yeah. Keep yourself alive.
I think we had very little idea of what was going to happen. We had a few dreams and a few ambitions. And the biggest thing was to actually make an album and have an album on the piece of plastic and have it there so that people could buy it and perhaps our children could still buy it and their grandchildren. And the second thing was to play some of the concert situations that we knew, like we knew the Rainbow. And when we had achieved those aims, I think everything was new from that point on. I can't remember really realizing where we were going, except that we were kind of going up. And it seemed like the world was endlessly new, you know. It seemed like we can always get bigger and better and more exciting.
Earnings at this point did not reflect the hits they'd had.
But we still didn't have any money, or we didn't get any money. I think Queen was paid £50 a week, like £200 a month. Trident Studio would, you know, take all the royalties or would take all the money which came in from the record companies and would never really distribute it. I don't know what they did with it then, but we all of a sudden noticed that they were, you know, buying another Rolls Royce. And there was us. Queen was still living in terrible basement flats.
I touch your lips with mine, but in the end, I leave it to the Lord.
But from then on, it started. We all started kind of questioning why we didn't have any money, because Freddie wanted to buy a piano. And they made a problem out about that. And the bass player, John Deacon, wanted to get married, and he wanted to buy just a little, stupid little house in Fulham, which didn't cost very much, and he needed £2,000, which, if nothing, is the down payment. And I remember one of the Sheffield brothers saying to him, "But you know, who do you think you are? We don't need to give you this money. We are not obliged to give you any money." And these kind of statements were coming out.
Do you like my claws? They're real diamonds. It's a present from the devil himself. You don't believe me? They don't believe me!
I first met them in December 74 when they came into my office, and Freddie kicked off the meeting straight away. It was the first thing he said to me, basically, which was they had three hit albums and their manager had just bought his second Rolls Royce and they were earning £60 a week and something seemed to be wrong.
Queen soon set about ironing out the peculiarities that bothered them, and finally parted company with the people that had managed them from the very beginning.
I said it would probably be about 5 years, and it was 4 years and 9 months.
Does he regret having lost the band?
Oh yes, I'd be stupid to say not.
For Queen, the final breakthrough into the big league was yet to come. It would take a very extraordinary song to achieve it. Remember?
Mama. Mama. I can't remember the song.
Just killed a man. Gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead.
Well, I remember the first time I heard Bohemian Rhapsody. I thought it was the most amazing dynamics I'd ever heard recorded on a record, you know. They actually used the fact that they could have silence or they could have total over-the-top power all within the space of, you know, 5 or 6 minutes or whatever. And a lot of groups made records that went along like this. Suddenly there was this thing like this, you know? And I used to listen to that over and over again. I thought, God, how did they do that?
Freddie was sitting in his apartment and he said, I've got this idea for a song. And he sort of sat down and sort of started playing the song and it was all going along good. And he sort of, you know, he had some words missing and some bits of melodies still hadn't quite worked out, but it was just the basic framework of the song. Then he said he was playing away and he stopped and said, now, dears, this is where the opera section comes in. I went, oh, my God. so we said, oh, OK, fine. This is the opposite. And it was just going to be, at the time, a little brief interlude of a little bit of, you know, a few little things like Galileos. So we said, oh, OK, fine. Stick a few little Galileos and then we get on to, like, the rock part of the song.
I see a little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
When we started doing the upper section properly, it just got longer and longer. We just kept adding blank tape to this thing and it got bigger and bigger and bigger. And every day we sort of thought, oh, this is it, we're done now. And then Freddie would come in with another lot of lyrics and say, I've added a few more Galileos here, dear. And so we'd put on a few more Galileos in and it just got bigger and bigger and bigger.
It was a very strange song to record, in a way, because we actually did it in sections. I mean, it was Freddie's idea, I think, you know. And I remember doing one recording session in Rockfield, where we were just, Freddie was saying, right, these are the notes, and it goes dum, 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 and it seemed to have no connection with anything, but he had all the ideas of what he wanted to go on top.
We phoned up the record company and said to the record company, well, we've got the single, it's ready to be heard. And they said, oh, great, what's it called? Is it called? Oh, it's called Bohemian Rhapsody. Oh, that sounds nice. They hadn't heard anything at that time. And we said, OK, the only problem is it's about 7.5 minutes long. They said, oh, forget it. Can't have a song. We said, but you haven't heard it yet. It says, doesn't matter. We'd never get any airplay. Radio will refuse to play it because it's too long.
It was one night I went to the studio when we had to make a decision and they had said, I think it was John Deacon, said, no, there's no way that that can go out in its entirety. And we must have sat there for about 3 or 4 hours debating it, but little did they know that it was already being pressed. I had already given the go-ahead and it was being pressed. And I was thinking, I hope we come to the right decision.
We got hold of a guy called Kenny Everett. Now, Kenny Everett is, in my opinion, one of the best disc jockeys in England. He's a very funny character. And we dragged him along to the studio and said, listen, Kenny, just listen to this. Would you play this? And he listened to it. He says, ah, oh, this is wonderful. He says, this is great. Ah, oh, I'd love to play this all the time. So we said, OK, fine. He says, can I have a copy? And he said, well, we can't let you have a copy. We haven't even played it to the record company. He says, I promise I won't play it. Honest, I promise I won't play it. And he'd do things like, well, I was out with over at the studios with Queen last night and I've got a copy of the record, but I promised them I would not play them. I can't help it. Oh, my record, my hand slipped. And he put it after the record. He'd play the intro and it'd rip it off again. He says, sorry, I can't play this. Over the course of those 2 days, he played the record 14 times.
Nothing really matters. Anyone can see.
Length didn't matter either. And with his friendly help, the initially unloved Bohemian Rhapsody became Queen's first number one on the national charts, where it reigned for 9 consecutive weeks.
As I said, the results for this award ended in a draw. The record that shares the award for the best British single from 1952 to 1977 is Bohemian Rhapsody by Queen. Ladies and gentlemen, Queen. There we are. Such a beautiful number. There we are.
Right. And whilst Bohemian Rhapsody propelled Queen's career into orbit, it also marked the beginning of a new genre that was soon to dominate pop.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. Easy go, little high, little low. Any way the wind blows doesn't really matter to me.
I think without a doubt that as soon as we saw Bohemian Rhapsody, anybody, we were aware that this was a possible new development in the making.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah, no.
And without a doubt, also, we decided that the success of that number could be put down to the video. Because everybody was talking about it, everybody was saying, they weren't not talking about the music, but that wasn't the principal thing they were talking about. The thing they were talking about was, have you seen that the picture?
That's sort of given credit for being the first promo as such. Yeah, that was done in a day and cost about 5,000 quid. And looking back, I just think it couldn't be done now. You couldn't do that.
Right, Brookie, you can tell them to roll it whenever you like. You take rolling or cut it.
Hold on, we've got to get rid of that. Yeah, that's fine. Just get Freddie to leave that brandy bottle on there.
Here it comes. Yeah, stand by.
It's a white shot all through.
4 to vocal. 3, 2, 1 vocal.
No, he's late on that.
It's difficult, you see, because you can't count.
A lot of effort went into the development of Queen as video artists. And as we can see from these rare outtakes of We Will Rock You and Spread Your Wings promos, the road to video success was long and hard, with the band freezing in Roger's garden whilst the director chastises Freddie.
Could you ask Freddie to make sure that he thinks about his sink, because he goes well off?
Oh,
camera
rocking,
then, isn't
it? Yeah. Can you clear out rock? Nothing can be easy
to hear. Potty, could you start on those feet?
Oh, yes! I love it. There you are.
Will.
See, that's a bit more interesting.
Yeah.
And for the directors, even the band's names were a problem.
If you could ask that, the guitar player, what's his name, Brian? Does anybody know his name, then? Guitar player. Him.
I want to ride my bicycle. Now, I can't know whose idea, whether it evolved or whether it was a joke one night when we were all drunk and having a good time, wouldn't it be good if we had a bicycle race all full of naked women? You say black,
I say white. Special effects had to be used to obscure the nudity in the bicycle race video. Here, for the first time, we can enjoy them in all their natural glory.
They got virtually every model who would pose naked on a bicycle to race in this bicycle race.
I want to ride my bicycle.
bicycle company who loaned us the bicycles for it got all the bicycles back, and they complained to us that they had to change all the bicycle seats after the shoot.
Bicycle races are coming your way.
So forget all your duties, oh yeah.
You don't just have to be a musician going to a recording studio and record a song. Now you have to try and think the songs in terms of the visuals.
I gotta be cool, relax, get in, and get on my tracks. Take a backseat, hitchhike, take a long ride on my motorbike. It's all ready,
ready,
raise a little thing all over.
I don't look too bad for 37, I tell you.
Our songs generally have stories, you know, they're about people, and very often they do suggest pictures, which is why we got into video so early, I think, as well.
5, 2, 1. Many takes were sometimes necessary to achieve the desired effect.
But yeah, I think our music is quite visual. It does lend itself to visual things. It's sort of quite big. It's sort of widescreen, cinemascope.
Working with film was an inevitable next step for Queen, and Flash Gordon marked their first involvement with a major motion picture.
Most of it we actually played watching the film in the old traditional manner, like the orchestras used to do, you know, conducting and watching the thing, and when his hand comes down, comes the bang.
Ah, King of the Impossible.
You have to try something different as well. And Freddie had some strong ideas, and in the absence of any other really good ideas, then you go with it.
Right, front, and right, look with the head. Right, hold. Right, and front. Right, and front. Right, and front. Keeping straight lines, you say. Come on, sharpen up.
The productions for videos became gigantic. More outrageous ideas required ever more elaborate staging. And soon, certain productions came to resemble large-scale epics like Fritz Lang's Metropolis.
Dying to dress up in drag, doesn't everybody? But it was just one of those things. In fact, it wasn't my idea at all. I'm sure everybody thinks it's my idea being outrageous.
It was Rogers, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, it came from Roger, and I was, and everybody thinks, I bet. In fact, they asked me, so how did you get the other three to get into it? In fact, they ran into their frocks quicker than anything.
Most rock and roll musicians would like to be comedians. And of course, most comedians want to be rock and roll musicians. I think perhaps we should come to some arrangement whereby we all sort of swap over.
I want to break free. I want to break free.
The video for I Want to Break Free parodies Britain's longest running soap opera, Coronation Street.
I don't want my freedom.
these days they've become, I think, too important. Too much emphasis is placed on that, to the detriment of the music. I think it's affecting the music in a bad way, because if you think about it, music is really for the ears. And I think when it's maybe a new art form, I don't know, but the marriage of the two doesn't always work.
You win, you lose. It's a chance you have to take with love. Oh yeah, I fell in love, but now you say it's over and I'm falling apart.
He's a performer and then he's Freddie. And when you're sitting there working things out, he looks at himself as a performer, as an actor, as an entertainer. And you're taking sketch. I never take polished sketches into Freddie with colour on, because I know he's going to pick up a pencil and want to draw all over me. So I get a selection together and I say, we could do it this way, that way. And he's drawn into it because he has art training. He'll actually start sketching all over my drawings and going, no, let's do it like this.
After doing videos for a long time, I don't normally buy their records and listen to them at home because I'm so sick and tired of the music. But Queen was actually one of the few bands I would actually go out and buy records off and listen to their music.
Is this the kind of magic? It's a kind of magic. Can be all.
When it came up to doing Highlander, and I didn't know how they were going to react, and I only wanted them to do one song in the film. And they saw the footage and they said, we'll do five songs.
Here we belong, fighting to survive in a war with the darkest power.
Instead of just having the video of the group and then cutting in bits of the film, which seemed just like a commercial for the film, to make the whole thing work, this is for the film, from the film.